I'm so happy that the week came to an end. And you guys are like, oh, I could have gone to the whole week without a break. I'm not even talking about Sabbath is here. I am so excited that you guys are here for the worship weekend that has been planned for, I don't know how long. Actually, we started this whole vision of a worship weekend right after we had a youth conference last year. So I'm really excited just to see how, like, you know, I have a vision and it actually comes true. And you see it happening, it's really nice. It's like, wow, it actually happened. So I am really excited and happy that each and one of you are here this evening. You guys could have been anywhere else. There's plenty of programs going on tonight, but you chose to be here, and it's a wonderful blessing. And I see God's presence in here, honestly.
Amen.
So you are great for all of us having you here. I don't know about you, but I need some feedback. I'm about to be like my dad right now.
Oh, man.
Opportunity to speak to you guys. And to give you some details of what to expect in August and give you our tips of our team, as you can see on the ship, and how wisely you started the new conference. So before I begin, let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you so much for this event. Thank you so much for bringing all of us here. I ask that as I speak, that you speak to me and some of the voices I'll be giving out tonight, God. Continue to be here. We're ready for your presence, God, and we're the ones that you're among us for tonight. And isn't that great? Amen.
Amen.
Okay, so before I begin, I just want to get something really clear. This weekend is about you and God. Okay? It's not about you and your mom and your dad. It's about you and God. So this weekend, I want you to repeat after me. This weekend
is about
me.
Me.
And God.
And God.
Me and who?
God.
Me and who?
God.
Okay. Because I know some of us sometimes when we hear a word like, oh my word, yeah, our church needs to hear that word. No. It's about us and God.
Yes.
Don't think about someone else. Think about yourself.
Amen.
Okay? So excuse me if you see me like this or like crying or something, because it's about the cross and God.
Yeah.
So we're going to, let's just, you know, keep that in mind as we worship Him this weekend. Continuing, but this church, while we meet, SCA Church, the one that you're here, has touched many people. I know it's not how to say this, but I thought a couple of guys might know. They say this. I've touched many people. Anyway, but this church has touched many people from all over the world. And, no, honestly, no, it really has. And thinking about it, this church has been run on the energy of the youth. And this is where many youth have practiced many skills, from leadership skills to their vocal skills to their instrument skills to becoming a deacon or even becoming a preacher, aka Johnson.
Amen.
But yet, this generation that you see here this evening, wanted to make a tradition where we can bring many youth to one event. And where we get to talk about things that us youth have been dying to talk about, but not really have the nerve to ask or do. So that's why we started to do the holding of Why Do We Eat Conference. So let me give you some background. Of course, the first one that we had was in 2009. And to be honest, we're all nervous. We didn't know how it was going to turn out. But it turned out to be a great weekend. And we moved forward in our teenage wars by the help of many workshop speakers and even our main speaker, who was Pastor Barrett Grace, which was a blessing. Then 2010 we came, and everyone again was excited, and we were looking forward to the youth conference. The committee, our planning committee, tried to make things better than the last year. But the weekend turned out to come to a close to our case of dealing with identity crisis and learning about how we are kings and queens of God by the help of our speaker that year, which was Obed the Lord. 2011, the third year, it was hard taking a seat. You guys remember that meeting? Taking a seat? Taking a seat was really hard. But we finally came to a conclusion, a theme, and one that honestly blessed my heart by learning how to be still in the midst of our chaos. And it was a blessing to see Ezra and Ware, the main speaker, to speak from his heart, and we can't forget our very own Johnson, who spoke that Friday night. Now it's 2012. 2012 is here. You're probably wondering, why is the theme of man in the mirror? Who are you reflecting? Some may ask, okay, are we dealing with identity crisis again? Or are we talking about the song, Michael Jackson song? I'm talking about the man in the mirror. No, we're not talking about that. You see, God calls each one of us to live according to His word. And in reality, I'm going to be real tonight, I'm not living according to His word. And so this theme is basically a theme where we look at the word being our mirror, okay? And we are the man in the mirror. Now looking in that mirror and then looking at me, I'm not living according to that. And so that's why we chose this theme, so we can have a reality check to see, are we living according to His word? Do we want to make it to heaven? So that's why we chose that theme. And our theme text comes from 2 Corinthians 3, verse 18. You can look at it. But it says that all of us reflect the Lord's glory with faces that are not covered with veil. We are being changed into His image with ever-increasing glory. This comes from the Lord who is in the Spirit. Now the video that I had for you guys showed an example of that, but I'm just going to explain the video to you so you can get to see it tonight. But the video was talking about this girl who they're basically saying, yeah, this girl has changed many lives. And the narrator is like, okay, you might wonder how she changed these three other people from three different world lives. And it talks about how she had a roommate, I think she was in college, and her roommate was talking to her, and she wanted to know what that girl was doing, what she was doing in her life to be on this right track. Then after she ministered to her, she ministered to somebody else. And after she ministered to somebody else, you know what I'm talking about, just going over school like that. So when I watched that video, I was like, wow, man, you can touch many lives just by how you influence one person.
In other words,
who are you reflecting can attract somebody else to that mirror that you're checking yourself in. And once that person, you know, sees, oh, I wonder what Hannah's mirror, I wonder what she's looking at, I want to know that mirror. Then somebody will get in the hat, you know, like, okay, I want to know that. And once that person knows that mirror, and then when that person changed, and then when Michael sees me, and he's like, wow, I want to know that when he's checking, you know, then it goes on like that. So I was just trying to go, okay, well, it does really matter who you are reflecting, because people are watching you.
Yeah.
Are we together?
Yeah.
All right. So back to my question. If we're reflecting the world, okay, it's like I said, how like I'm not really according to the word. But if we're reflecting the world, how are we going to make it to heaven? You know, you can answer the question, well, you know, I've been doing crazy, I've been playing the job, and doing all this all my life, or I've been great in school, I obey my parents, I haven't, you know, gotten pregnant, I'm a teenager, or, did you see what he or she did? Yeah, that's not going to cut it. You know, trust me, God gave me a reality check, but I like to call it a reality slap in the face, because we can't live a double standard life to proclaim that we're living accordingly to what God says.
Amen.
We're human. I know that for a fact. Yes, we do make mistakes, a lot of them. But by the help of the Holy Spirit, we can manage to live a life that reflects Christ. Just like how the text says, we all have the power to reflect Christ when we're not covering up. We can be changed into His image.
Amen.
So, I have an example of checking your mirror. So, you know how a mirror is there to fix your damage the night before when you wake up, you look in the mirror and you're like, oh, I need to fix this. So I had an example, I made an example, I thought it was funny to me. I was like, you know how like you wake up in the morning and then like that one day that you like, you're like, oh yes, I'm gonna get a new day, so you wake up and you're like feeling really good and just smiling while you're waking up and you're like, yeah, I'm gonna take a picture and put it on Facebook and say, good morning, Facebook, you know, little pictures like that. And then you get in the bathroom and then you look at yourself and like, oh no, I can't take a picture like this. You're like, oh, I got some saliva all dried up on my face, or your hair is all messed up, or whatever, and then you start all being like, oh my God, fix my stuff, Lord, I need to jump the shower, I need to wash my face. You see, a mirror is used to fix the damage that you've done before.
Come on.
See, God says a mirror reflects what we're like on the outside. And God's word reflects on like what we're like on the inside.
Yes.
And at the end, it's really going to matter what it is like on the inside. Yes. Now, I'm almost out of your way because it's introduction. Remember, I'm not saying it's introduction. But I like to share a story that I thought was with this. I took American Literature last semester. I really liked that class. And there's a story that we read. It was called The Minister's Black Veil. And the minister's name in this story is Minister Hopper. Okay? So Minister Hopper, of course, was Minister Richard. And so there was at one point in his life he started wearing a black veil. And everybody was like, why is he wearing a black veil? To cover his face. Everybody questioned. And it wasn't one day. It continued on and on and on. And so everybody was questioning, why is he wearing a black veil? You know, from the congregation, to his family, to even his fiance. It was like, why are you wearing that black veil? He even preached to me. But, so it was until there was this committee that was being formed, like, you know, we need to fix this. We need to figure out why he's wearing this black veil. And so then, we're like, no, actually, wait. Why don't we just ask the fiance to go ask the minister, why are you wearing this black veil? So then the fiance goes, okay, I can do that. So the fiance goes, you know, whatever, couple of things. Why are you wearing that black veil? Okay, I'm just imagining. But, you know, why are you wearing that black veil? You know, I'm just like, guys, give you that scarlet treatment, like, I can do what I want. So that's what the minister just didn't even answer back. So, homegirl, left him. Left him.
Wow.
Just because he wouldn't answer the question. So, I was telling his death bed that he was still wearing that black veil. So then, his ex-fiance came back, you know, to do good deeds and help the nurses to be, like, you know, while he was on his deathbed. Then another minister came, and he asked him, he's like, why are you still wearing that black veil? Can't you take it off? And Minister Hopper, I'm not taking off this veil. And then there's this quote that he said to the minister, he was like, why do you tremble at me alone? Tremble also at each other. Have men avoided me, and women shown me no pity, and children screamed and fled, only because of my black veil? So, I'm not going to continue the story, but the black veil represents a secret sin. My point of sharing this story is to show that we young men and women have a secret sin that we're hiding. But we shouldn't be ashamed of our sin because we all have sinned. And since we want to become more like Christ, not just to show, you know, just for the show on the outside, but on the inside, we must confess that sin. And since we want to confess that sin, it's because we have that desire to reflect Christ, we have that power. So I want to give a few pointers that we can use as we wake up in the morning when we look at the mirror, which is God's word. Is there a sin that I need to confess? Is there a problem I need to claim? Is there an attitude I need to change? Is there a command that I need to obey? Is there an example that I need to follow? Is there a prayer that I need to pray? Is there an error that I need to avoid? Is there something that I need to thank God for? Those are a few points we can use. We need to stop living lives so blindly. God wants us to be like those strangers in the video reflecting Christ. God wants us to have that desire so that our black veil can come off, because we all have fallen short at one point. God wants us to have that desire to reflect Him. He wants us to know that we have that power to become more like Him. It's not easy, but it can happen. This year, it's all about reflecting God, so that on that glorious day, He doesn't just say, well done. He says, no. He will say, well done, my servant. You really reflected me. Not only on the outside, but on the inside.
Amen.
So, this is it.
Amen.
2012, a man in Ramirez. Who are you reflecting? Why do we see upon him? August 17th to 19th, you really don't want to miss it. We're going to have two amazing speakers. On Friday night, we have our very own Mrs. Jeanine Hampton, who's going to be giving us the word. And Saturday, we have Mr. Edward Woods III, who's going to be speaking. So during this worship weekend, where again it's about you and who?
God.
You and who?
God.
Ask Him what you need to get together. Ask Him what you need to do. Or get on the right track, so that you're reflecting Him. Not only on the outside, but on the inside. Because doing on the outside here is not going to help you. It's just going to mess you up. It really is. So not only on the outside, but on the inside. I hope that each one of you make it to our youth conference in August, because I really do believe that God is going to bless tremendously. But I really also hope that you guys will be blessed this weekend by giving us all the praise and the glory and the honor you deserve. And during this worship weekend, it's just a preview. You don't want to give you a lot for what's happening in August, but during this worship, we can just let it go. Like I said at the beginning, just shake it off. Let it just be you, about you and God. Talk to Him if you need to. Talk to Him, even if you feel like what do I speak, and just talk to Him secretly, like, God, what do I need to do to get right where I'm reflecting? Outside, but on the inside. Because that's what's going to make healthy get to heaven. And I want to be there.
Amen.
I want to be in heaven.
Amen.
I want to be in heaven where praise and worship don't stop. I want to be there where I get to see all the loved ones that I've lost in the past. And it doesn't mean that I need to ask God today, on this day, March 30, 2011, to start fixing me up so I can reflect Him, not only on the outside, but on the inside. I'm going to do that this weekend.
Amen.
You can do whatever you need to do, but in here, that's what's all that matters. So, do the Spirit of Worship weekend. And we continue to worship Him. Don't get tired. Because
right.
I don't know what you're going to do in heaven if you get tired.
Yeah. Amen.
So I've seen things that come out. I've been singing a couple more worship songs. Love it. It's about you and God. Mainly, it's about you and God. Can you see that? It's about you and God. And so it's about you and God this weekend. It's about you and God. So I hope you guys are blessed.
Amen. What a word. Reflection. Thank you. because I know I'm not perfect. I know I'm even deserving of this mind in my hand. But I'm not up here because of me. Because he is so worthy. Because he decided one day.
All the glory of the Lord. Thank you. Thank you.
we do things here to worship Him. There's a lot of things you can do to worship God, but one of